If I sound like a cheerleader today, it's because I am. Wonderful progress and clarity has come. But as usual, I want to stay, you know, humble about it. I understand severe continuity fear. So try to stay, you know, low-key, calm, low-key. Say, okay, very good. What I'm doing is working. It's expected. It is working. So I'm on the right path. I'm on the right, going in the right direction for sure. I'm very, very upbeat. Tremendous clarity this morning. Tremendous. So I just have to let that, you know, settle in. When you reach that point of that, just say, okay, that's fine. I expect that. That's good. Not unexpected. Not entirely unexpected. It's like going around, you're on a mountain road, you go around a turn, and at one point you go around this turn and there's the valley, you see the panorama. It's like, wow, the view opens up. I say, oh, wow, that's nice. Really, the simplicity has opened up. So I do recommend to continue on, everyone continue on. Basics 216, July of 216, I believe, this new script for the planet will have crystallized. If you're not able to get on that script, they will interpret this as meaning you're dead. And just like dead plants in the garden, dead branches on a tree, they say, oh, we got to remove these plants. Right? So they will do all this trimming to remove what they see as dead. Keep in mind that if you're not able to go along with the new script for this planet, that is interpreted by them as you're dead, you don't exist, that's why you're not able to do it. I say, oh, okay, well, they're not be able to do it, not because they have a different belief system, but they say, oh, no, they're dead. See, they don't acknowledge there's a different belief system at all. So inability to go along with their script equals you must be dead. And then they'll just say, we've got to clean up all this dead debris here. That's their conclusion of coming from the position of the unrepentant ones. That's a conclusion. To repent means to accept that there are no exceptions or exemptions whatsoever, that reality makes no exceptions, no exemptions to reality, never, never, and never. Therefore you realize then you have a continuity fear. That's the only conclusion you can draw. My teaching is very simple. What I wanted to do in this world is bring in a new streamlined teaching, simplified, streamlined, to help go forward in the future. Those who repent, they need a streamlined, simple, more streamlined teaching than what we've had in the past. So that this has been my goal, and I feel I've reached it, basically. Everyone has the same problem, which is the continuity problem. That's the only problem there is. Everyone has exactly the same problem. Now, the degrees of severity differ, because the goal is to evaporate the continuity fear. So everyone has evaporated different amounts of the continuity fear. But the problem is exactly the same for everyone. Same problem. Exactly the same destiny for everyone, which is everyone will eventually evaporate their continuity fear and realize that this moment is a perfect moment. All moments are perfect moments. All moments are perfect moments as far as the moment goes. Now, you may want to, the next moment, you may want to have a different appearance arising, but each moment contains exactly the appearance that you have asked for in that moment, and that moment is perfect moment. Okay, it doesn't require past or future to it. No moment requires a past or future. Every moment is perfect and it's perfect in itself. This is the ultimate realization. So, one problem, same problem for everyone, same destiny for everyone. This simplifies the whole situation to an extraordinary extent. You just feel like a burden being lifted off of you. Wow, I don't have to go through all these different explanations. Now, There are two classes of people, so to speak, spirits, repentant and unrepentant spirits. The unrepentant spirits are still trying to get an exception or exemption for themselves, claiming that the continuity fear is too severe, they'll never be able to solve it, deal with it. So they're trying to get an exception from God, in other words, claiming they're special. And in not being able to do that, then they want an exemption. They can earn an exemption. So first they have it's a total dualistic claim. I'm special, so I'm an exception. And also they're saying, well, I can also work on earning an exemption from God, from reality. Earning an exemption. What they're aiming for is for God to say, okay, for you, the past does determine the present, and the present does determine the future. In other words, you're not free, you're imprisoned in this indeterminacy, and for you, that's going to be your new reality. That's what they're aiming for. This is impossible. It will never happen. Every moment is completely free and clear of every other moment. Reality is completely spontaneous and indeterminate. Total freedom, total freedom. This will never change, no exception to this, and no exemptions can ever be earned. But the unrepentant are furiously working, and they have this whole system, it's literally like a pyramid scam, multi-level pyramid scam, where those at the top are those at the bottom believe have the capability to get an exemption for them from God. That they have some deities at the top of the pyramid. This pyramid have the capacity to go to God and say, "Hey, God, you know, I'm asking through my merit to get an exemption for those below me." See, and of course, those at the top say to those at the bottom, "Hey, you need to boost my confidence and inspire me in order to go to God to get this exemption. So you need to make my life really wonderful for me." And so it's an enslavement. Those on the bottom are working to make the life wonderful for those that are higher up. And it goes all the way up to the top of this pyramid scam. And people, unrepentant spirits, are desperately struggling to get to a higher level of this pyramid scheme, just like a multi-level marketing scheme, where the more you pull in, customers you pull in and get a revenue stream coming to you, of course you give part of that revenue stream to someone who's higher on the chain, on a higher level than you, and they give some of theirs to those who are higher up, you know. So all this base of the pyramid filters up to the ones at the very top. And the few at the very top are really getting all the money. And so those in the mid-level are desperately struggling to pull more people into the scam so they can at least survive. But the money's really going up to the top. Okay. Not just the money, but the comfort in this world. It's a pyramid scheme. Multi-level marketing pyramid scheme. The unrepentant, desperately trying to earn an exception from God. Now, what those at the top tell everyone is that God does make exemptions, and there are exceptions, and God does make exemptions. That's what those at the top tell. That's the ideology of this pyramid. Now, how this works is, then those who are struggling for an exemption, those at the top say, "Well, you didn't get one," and then they automatically assume, and they're told, "Well, God's angry at you, very disappointed in you. You didn't please God." And you say, "Well, how do I please God?" And they say, "Well, since I'm God's representative, pleasing me will please God." You see, like that. So as soon as you believe that God makes exceptions and you can earn exemptions, then you will automatically believe that if you don't get them, God's angry at you or disappointed in you. You failed God. You sinned against God. You have guilt. You will automatically, dualism automatically arises like that. As soon as you believe that God makes any exception and can make, and you, anyone can earn exemptions from God, you will automatically believe in sin, in guilt, and God is angry, disappointed, and you'll have this terrible relationship with God because you feel you need to please God somehow by what you're doing. And so you will go to those higher in the pyramid and they'll tell you, "Yes, I can get God to stop being angry at you. If I have the power, I have the merit with God. God loves me so much that I can go to God and say, 'Hey, God, you know what, you love me so much, so do me a favor, make an exemption for this one. And then they think, God will say, oh, sure, I don't want to lose your love here. I don't want this relationship to be disturbed with my favorite here, so I'll grant an exemption. So this is a scam, entirely a scam. And those caught up in this, of course, say, well, I need to please those higher in the pyramid because they have the capacity to get rid of God's anger towards me. You see, disappointment towards me. God makes, there's no exceptions, no exemptions whatsoever. God is a God of pure love. Therefore, there's no anger, no disappointment, no sin against God, no guilt. No way you can displease God whatsoever. Every moment is a perfect moment. All has perfect freedom, total freedom. God loves all unconditionally. No preferences for whatever spirit wants to experience. God has no preferences. We're perfectly free. God says, whatever you want to experience, I totally love it. Love. So there's no anger from God. There's no way to please God. There's no way to sin against God. There's no way to be disappointed. This whole pyramid scheme is a total scam. But when you're caught up in it, it's horrible. It's really horrible. It's an enslavement. And the ideology, it's not just those at the top that are holding this ideology in place. It's the whole pyramid is holding this whole ideology in place. Because those at the bottom, they're unrepentant. And they're saying, I need a way to get an exception or exemption. So they buy into it. You can't just blame those at the top. You have to see the whole situation for what it is. Now, of course, those at the top are in a very bad situation. Quote, unquote. They're a difficult situation because they got all comfortable. I mean, they have all this comfort going to them, making this world seem like, wow, the world's my oyster. And they're very afraid of losing that. So they very much struggle to keep themselves up at the top. But in doing so, of course, they just continuously reinforcing delusion for themselves. Continuously reinforcing it. So eventually they will start falling down the ladder, as it were. So you do not want to try and get up to the top of that pyramid. It's a very bad place to be. Everybody worshiping you, everybody giving you all their energy, all their love and worship, and say, yeah, you can do it for me, you can do it, I'll give you everything, just do it for me. And you know, there's those at the top who encourage that, absolutely encourage that. But on the other hand, they don't like the position too. Some part of them is saying, wow, I want to get out of this, this is horrible, I mean, I just feel like trapped here, you know. So, again, everyone has exactly the same problem, which is a continuity fear. Exactly the same problem. Now, those at the top who have been lying to everybody, they think that God must be angry with them. No, not at all. Not at all. God has no anger whatsoever. No disappointment whatsoever. So they have exactly the same problem as everyone. Continuity fear is the only problem there is. This helps dissolve the whole pyramid. Continuity fear is the only fear problem. Continuity problem is the only problem there is. Everybody has exactly the same problem. All on equal footing. Everyone has exactly the same destiny, all on equal footing. You don't need to see yourself in this pyramidal sort of situation. So what we need to do is sort of dissolve the whole pyramid scheme here, you see. Forgive yourself for buying into it, pushing those ahead up on top, saying, you have to do this for me. For God, you have to get exemption for me. And those on top, forgive yourself for lying to everybody, saying, yeah, I can do it, but you just are not pleasing me enough, and so God is not quite satisfied enough in the relationship that has with me, so that's why I can't get the exemption for you yet, so you have to please me more. All this needs to be forgiven, and laughed away. This is just how delusion functions, you know. And and of course, there's all these intrigues, because you'll get someone at the top and someone beneath them a little bit will say, hey, you know, you're not getting it done. I'm going to tell all the people that you're not able to get it done. And the ones at the top say, no, don't say that. And they say, okay, well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell the people that they need to please me, that I'm an intermediary to the one at the top. And the reason why the one at the top is not succeeding is because they don't have the full appreciation of those beneath them. And I'm going to say that if they all support me more, then I'll be able to support you more, and then you'll be able to get the job done. So the ones at the top are actually being constantly undermined by their understudies, so to speak. And this is how it works. Uneasy head that wears the crown, you know, because they can't get the job done. So those underneath them can easily undermine and exploit them and blackmail them, say, hey, I'm going to spill the beans that you're ineffective unless you agree that I'm some intermediary that has power with you, who can you know, so I need to get all the worship for me, and then I'll give the merit to you, and then you can go to God. And so there's all the schemes and struggles among all these so-called deities, those at the top of the pyramid. We think they're deities, they're not. There's only just the oneness. There are no deities, actually. No deities at all. There's only the oneness, the isness, that is God, that is all. That is all. All right. That's all there is. All there is all there is. So there's no such thing really as true deities at all. All right. This is just all a pyramid scam. Wherever you are, you're always exactly where you've always been, which is in this perfect moment. And this is true for all. So each moment is always perfect for all. So how can there be any deities that are higher or lower? They're not. They are not. Jesus insists that he's exactly the same as us. Insists upon it. Insists all are exactly the same, which is true, which means perfect freedom for all. Every moment is a perfect moment. Okay, now, we can look at this a little bit. If we can move this forward, I don't know. We'll see. Now, of course, in my teaching, there are four phases to, and it's not in just my teaching, in this streamlined teaching, which has been a joint effort from Jesus, Longjenpa, the Holy Spirit, Ramana Maharshi, and Anamaya Ma, sort of overall effort to streamline. But I think primarily you look at Jesus as the one and the Holy Spirit, who, and with an assist from Longjenpa for sure, who's been working on this, helping streamline this all. And what I'm seeing is there are four phases. Once you repent, then you're on the path. Repentance, again, is to say there's no exceptions or exemptions can ever be gained or earned. It's impossible. I'm not an exception. No one's an exception. I'm not an exemption. I can't earn exemptions. No one can. Therefore, I have a severe continuity problem. I realize I can't quite accept that this moment is perfect. So I have this continuity problem. Then you get to work on the continuity problem. And I see four basic phases with this. Four basic phases that need to work through. Now, what happens to the unrepentant ones? They keep trying to earn exemptions. So they keep being reborn, saying, I haven't earned an exemption yet. The whole pyramid scheme continues. It's more than just this life, it's the afterlife too. It all continues. You say, oh, you didn't get the exemption yet. Have to learn more lessons. Please God more. Reborn. Now, when you're repentant and you work on the continuity fear, that's not necessary anymore. Okay, it's not necessary. If you evaporate the continuity fear, no more rebirth for you. So you realize, this moment is perfect. Now, phase one might take quite some time, and you may go through various rebirths, and even in phase one. It's phase one is pretty difficult. Phase two, once you get going with phase two, you can do it in the one lifetime. Two, three, and four. You can do phase two, three, and four in one lifetime. Finish. Absolutely, you can. But it takes a all-out effort on your part. But what else is there to do? Either do that, or you get back in the pyramid scheme and end up in this hideous enslavement and anger and feelings of drama and deception and intrigue. And it's horrible. Step out of that. Repent and step out of that pyramid scheme. No exceptions. Pure, unequivocal, no exceptions. That's it. Have faith in that. Now, of course, the ones of the pyramid scheme lies about those who've repented and claiming that God made, that they're special. They're exceptional. God made an exception. They didn't have to, you know, now they have this determinate reality. Not true at all. They also lie and say they earned exemption. Not true at all. There's no exemptions to earn whatsoever, and no one is special. No one is an exception to perfect freedom, perfection. There are no exceptions. No exemptions can ever be earned. This is the bedrock confession of faith. Bedrock confession of faith. Pure, unequivocal, no exceptions, no exemptions. It's pure, it's unequivocal, no exceptions, no exemptions. This is the confession of repentance. And then from there, you begin to then exchange belief systems of the determinant for the indeterminate belief system. And you go through like a long road, a winding road, long and winding road is what you go through. But it's interesting. It's an interesting journey. Difficult one, but interesting. Because you say, wow, maybe this is true. You know, maybe that, and you start seeing the difference. You know, wow, it looks like I'm starting to, you know, get free, and I think I will be able to finally be happy, and, you know, on and on. Now, when you get to the fourth phase, you know, the practice of each phase is slightly different. You have to have patience, practice, and perseverance. The three P's, patience, practice, perseverance, in whatever order you want. But certainly you need patience, you need perseverance, and you need practice. The practice can differ in the different phases for sure. When you reach the fourth phase, you tend to give no explanation at all. And what you do is you face down this so-called opposition, the deceit, the self-deceit, self-deception. I had a dream last night where this happened. And the self-deception came at me as an entity, all dressed in black. And it said, I'm going to take over your job. I'm going to take you over. And it was trying to pin me down, you know, it was trying to intimidate me. And I said, great, do it this instant then. If you can't do it this instant, then you're going to disappear. Do it this instant. And, you know, this entity, this dark entity, you know, like, jump back like that. I discovered the kryptonite. You know, discovered the kryptonite for deception, self-deception. I said, do it this instant. I didn't argue or struggle or fearfully. No, please don't. Can I make a deal? I said, great, go ahead, do it this instant. If you can't do it this instant, then you're going to disappear. And this stunned this entity. This entity was stunned. So, this is the kryptonite. Don't explain. Fourth phase practice is being very successful. As I said yesterday, no residue. I kept doing that all day. It was very difficult. All sorts of feelings like I should give up. I'm a failure. I should commit suicide. I'm stupid. This is spiritual path. Does all this stuff. And I kept going back. Saying, no residue. I didn't give any explanation. I didn't struggle with it. Don't struggle with the struggle. No residue. Just no residue. There's no residue. No residue. And then this dream came up. I fleshed out the opposition. There's no residue. And then they said, I'm going to take you over now. I got to take you over. I said, go ahead. Do it this instant, though, or disappear. See, the ego, the delusion, operates the belief in time. So I said, do it this instant. Do it right now. I said, do it right now. They can't do it right now. They can trap you into the belief in time, which makes it then seem possible, makes it seem that this moment isn't perfect. Which means you believe that there are exceptions and exemptions, which means you fall into this pyramid scam. So I said, do it now. You're going to take me over? I said, okay, fine, do it now. Right now. So I insisted on the nowness, you see. And this was the kryptonite. No explanation. I said, do it now. So the fourth phase practice is not this dialogue with anything. It's just simple, very simple practice. Do it now. If you're going to try and change this moment, then do it now. Right now. Because, see, this energy was saying, I'm going to take over this moment. I'm going to take over your life. I'm going to take over your reality. I'm going to take over your job. And I said, fine, do it right now. Right now. And they couldn't do it now, which means they can't take over now, which means you're the ruler of now. This is your kingdom. Now is your kingdom. Now is our kingdom. Okay. So our kingdom cannot be taken over. So just insist on your kingdom. Don't argue. There's no argument. Just say, do it now or disappear. Do it now or you're nothing. Disappear. So in the third phase, second phase, first phase, it's not really that possible to practice like this. You can try a little bit and you have to start trying. But you also will feel like you need to enter in some dialogue of explanation of, okay, now how can we work out a compromise here? There's no compromise to work out. If there are no exceptions and no exemptions, what kind of compromise is there to work out with that in mind? Ideologically, there's no compromise, is there? If there's zero, what's the compromise? One? A half? Is that a compromise? No, there's no compromise. Pragmatically, there's an intermediate step in terms of appearance in the now, which we can keep the appearance of nature, which I call supernature. But that's not a compromise with truth, not at all. That's realizing, accepting there is no compromise with truth. And by accepting that, then we allow ourselves this appearance of supernature for the sake of continuity. Okay. Now, what the unrepentant ones will say, their ideology will say, well, if you say there's no exceptions, then you're accepting yourself from this. You're exempting yourself from this delusion. That's what's called level confusion, okay? Now, what is, to say that there's no exemption, to rest in truth, is not exempting yourself from truth at all. It's not exempting yourself from a lie at all. It's just saying that the lie doesn't exist. You're not exempting yourself from it. Lies are not true. It's not that you have to exempt yourself from a lie or be an exception to a lie. But this is what lies try to tell you. So it can get kind of confusing. Level confusion here. So we thank our teachers for their teaching, for sure. And fact is, we all have the inner teacher within us. Everyone does. No exception, no exemption to that. None. Holy Spirit, inner teacher, inner master, however you want to call it. Inner grace. And that's the real teacher. The rest are just, we're just reassurers, like it can be done. Yes, it can be done. So, as far as that which is with you, and you can turn to it all, every moment is this inner teacher. We don't reject those who have succeeded at evaporating the continuity of fear. We thank them for their work and their example, absolutely. And we listen to what they say, and we respect, etc. But we put the utmost emphasis on the inner teacher, the Holy Spirit that is always with us and guiding us every moment by moment by moment. Perfect moment by perfect moment by perfect moment. Now, those who are in like phase one will still have a strong attachment to the pyramid scheme of these deities up at the top who can gain an exception or exemption. So they may be following the example of a teacher, for instance, Jesus, who has evaporated all continuity fear and is accepted and knows that this moment is perfect. Each moment is completely perfect. But they still will see Jesus as a deity, as someone superior to them, as someone who can get an exemption from God. Maybe, you see, maybe. They're kind of like not sure about it. But they basically have dismissed all their deities, which is fine. See, that's phase one. Phase one has its characteristics about it. The first thing you have to do is dismiss this whole pyramid thing. But because you're so used to it, continuity issue, you're so used to it, you will bring some of that ideology into phase one. And so phase one is all about transition from the pyramid scam onto the spiritual path. And you gradually move away from God as some angry deity that needs to be appeased and sacrificed to. You gradually move away to that, and you sort of consolidate all that into just one deity, Jesus, who can get merit from God. And you dismiss the underlings, like the goddess underneath says, I can intercede with Jesus. He's not working, but I can get him to work with God and all that stuff. You gradually dismiss all this, and you just end up with just one deity. And then you start listening to what this one deity says, and this one deity says, God is a God of love, pure love. And so then you begin to trust this teaching, and then gradually you shift into phase two. Phase two is where you accept that God is not an angry God. So there's no, you can't sin against God. You can't do anything, make God angry whatsoever. And then you say, wow, I've got to rework my whole belief system then. That's true. So phase two is when you rework your belief system. Phase one is a transition away from this pyramid scam of deities and earning exceptions and exemptions. And phase one is transition away from that. Consolidation of that transition. Phase two is when you begin to rework your entire belief system. Phase three is when you simplify the rework of the belief system. So you really get into this new belief system and simplify and realize how easy it is. And then phase four is when you finally stand up to delusion and say, okay, you're going to take me over? Okay, do it now. You face up to the bully. And you say, you're going to disappear. You can't touch me. You can't touch this moment. You become very adamant in phase four. You're able to practice. You're able to really practice adamantly in phase four. Whereas in the previous ones, you weren't able to get this singular, adamant practice. Okay, but in phase four, you can. And then you really clean up. You really clean the whole situation up. Dismiss it. You simply dismiss the entire delusion. You just dismiss it. If you have the capacity, the continuity fear is so evaporated, then you're not afraid of just dismissing it. So those are the four basic phases. And those who repent are in one of those four phases. Okay, one of those four phases. And everyone's at a different place in those phases. There's transitions between each phase too. Okay, so you kind of transition into the next, and then you get into it, and then you transition into the next like that. And it's just all it is the amount of continuity fear that's still present in you. The more you evaporate it, the easier it is to get you going to a feeling like, hey, I can just dismiss this delusion. I can just say, do it now, or be just totally dismissed forever. Do it now. You say you can take over this moment and change it? Well, do it now then. Or be dismissed forever. So, one problem, continuity problem for everyone. One destiny for everyone. They will all dismiss delusion and say, this. Every moment is a perfect moment. Nothing can change that. Nothing can change. It cannot be changed. So any attempt to change what we are is totally ineffective and futile. Dismissed. And we dwell in the perfection of each moment. The absolute freedom and perfection of this moment, of the now, of the now. Now, in the phase four, I found that I got help from an extremely good teacher, great teacher, who specializes in phase four, which is Longchenpa, the great Tibetan Dzogchen master, who specializes in phase four, absolutely specializes in it. So I got this help. Jesus specializes in the entire situation, the whole thing. From the unrepentant spirits to getting into phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four, stupor nature, and ultimately formless existence, formless reality. He has a complete overview of the entire thing. That's his what he does. Longchenpa also has an overview of the entire thing, but what I experienced is he has this great specialty in phase four, great specialty in phase four. That's what Dzogchen really teaches, is once you get to phase four, don't worry about phase one, two, and three anymore. You know, he's realized that, hey, I had the power to dismiss all of this all along and just do it. Just do it. And Jesus also helps out in phase four, absolutely. But phase four is interesting, and it's where you find the strength to start practicing. Jesus in phase two, in one, two, three, he says, try to practice, start trying to practice. It's very important. Now, I didn't do a good job with that. I struggled, but I tried. It's a struggle. But at least the seeds were sown. Like, hey, I need to try and practice, and it was very difficult. But somehow I was able to start practicing, and then that transitioned into phase four. And it's not like you have to count every breath and say some mantra with every breath, and you know, that kind of, you know, mechanistic robotic practice. It's not like that. It doesn't have to be like that. It's that you actually adamantly, as I say, bring up this burn within you. No explanation, you know, no teaching, no teacher, no explanation, and then just stop right there. And this drives the ego crazy, you see, because the ego lives on dialogue and explanation. It lives on that. This is what keeps it going. And so when you just stop that, the ego gets frantic, you know, gets frantic. So what I've done is actually flushed the ego out of its hiding place. And when it flushed out, and it's out in the open, then it came after me and says, I'm going to change you. I'm going to take you over and change you. And I said, go ahead, do it right now. And it, you know, good. It's like, wow. So phase four, you flush the ego out. You flush it out. You flush it out by your practice. Your practice has to flush the ego out. And this is too frightening in phase one, two, and three. It's very frightening for that, because You want to avoid the ego. You want to avoid this you know, the heart of deception, the heart of delusion. You know, you want to avoid that. You say, no, I'm trying to avoid this, escape that. How can I escape it? But ultimately, you have to flush it out and have a confrontation. Say, I just said, go ahead and do it right now. Do it now, or you'll never do it, or you won't do it at all. And that's what the goal, getting to that, is what's called the fourth phase, getting to that. And where this confrontation does not completely unnerve you, you know, you will have confrontations in phase one, two, and three, and they will very much unnerve you, for sure. You'll say, my gosh, I can't do that, it's too scary, you know. It's continuity fear. So you just when you realize your problem is only one of continuity fear, and the ego is doomed. Okay, self-deception is doomed. Once you repent, it's doomed. Period. So don't worry about it. Just say, look, I'm gonna keep working, and keep evaporating this continuity fear, and eventually, this will unnerve me less and less and less. So what you need to do is practice little bits of unnervement, little bits of agitating the ego. No explanation, no teaching, no teacher, no student. This just comes from Punjaji. No teaching, no teacher, no student. I say, no explanation. No explanation. I don't know anything. Maybe. These are different practices. Maybe. But eventually you get no explanation. And that will flushes the ego out. You know, of course, we're afraid to flush the ego out. because it comes out like a champion. A dark knight comes out. And it tries to flip the script and you say, ah, finally I found you, huh? And tries to intimidate you like that. So if you're not really clear about it, you're going to, freak out. Say, no, I'm going to run away. And the ego will go back in hiding and think you're safe from it now. But no, flush it out. So the dark knight appears, the champion. I'm the greatest, the ego says. And I'm here to take you over. I say, okay, do it now. Do it now. Do it right now. This instant. So we have to practice flushing the ego out. Gently, step by step, little by little by little by little, you gain your courage. Little by little by little. The ego might peek from its hiding place and you see it, and you go, oh my God. Oh, that's scary. But then you peek a little again, you have to peek a little again, you're really fleshing it out. You're insisting it come out, you see. The less explanation you give, the more you flush the ego out in terms of your practice. The simpler you get in your explanation, the bigger the picture you get, the more you flush the ego out. And if you go no explanation whatsoever, then the ego has to come out because it lives on explanation. It lives on explanation. It lives on dialogue. It lives on the belief in compromise. It lives on the belief of sustaining itself through discussing some sort of possible compromise or something. It lives on that. So when you say no explanation, the ego feels it has no life to it. So it comes out and says, I'm going to take your life. That's what it said. I'm going to take you over. I'm going to take your life. And I said, go ahead, do it this instant. Goodbye, ego. And this is something we have to do within us. It's not, we can't go to some teachers, hey teacher, can you get rid of this ego for me? No, you have to, because we have within us a continuity fear. We have to actually face this moment, come to this moment ourselves. The teacher just reassures you can do it. You got to prepare for it, for sure. Prepare. Evaporate the continuity fear and just keep working at it. Eventually, you'll get into this range where you can flush the ego out entirely like this. So I'm at this point now where I understand the ego's been flushed out. I can flush the ego out and keep working on this. Evaporate my continuity fear around this. Fourth phase. All its tricks I've been see through. Reject this trick. Because the ego keeps telling you, hey, if you don't do what I tell you, I'm going to come take your life. See, if you don't feed me, keep feeding me, then I'm going to have to take over your life. So we keep trying to feed delusion, keep it alive, because we think if we keep feeding it, it won't come and take our life. But if we stop feeding it, it says it's going to come take our life over. It's going to take over our life completely. So I said, go ahead, do it right this instant. Do it this instant. And that's when the ego, that's when it got shocked. Came unglued. See, I saw the ego come unglued. Got all flustered. I didn't know what to say. Didn't know what to say or do or anything. Just, what? Huh? What? Like that. So I realized, hey, I got the power. Ego does not have the power. And not even power, I have the life. I have the life. It's not a power, I have the life. I am the life. This moment is the life. This moment is perfect. So, ultimately, we're going towards realizing this moment is perfect. This moment, as it is completely, is a perfect moment. This is, and no explanation, just rest in that. We're going towards that. just assert that. This moment is a perfect moment, full stop. This moment is a perfect moment. Now, I think this is the highest teaching you can get to. This moment is a perfect moment, full stop. No explanation, no residue, no explanation. No residue, no explanation. This moment is a perfect moment. Full stop. Don't try to explain it. Because the ego will start asking questions. No, don't answer any questions. No explanation. And we go on this on the faith of those who have done this before and have told us, you know, this is where it's at. This is true. Just assert this and insist upon it. This moment is a perfect moment. Without doing anything, without anything changing, this instant, without anything happening, this instant is a perfect instant. It's completely whole within itself. Doesn't require time or space at all. It is an absolutely immaculate, perfect instant. The immaculately virginal instant. Jesus, born of the Immaculate Virgin, means this is our life. This is where we live. The immaculate virginal instant is perfect. This immaculately virginal instant is perfect. This is our life. And so being born of that means the realization, this is life. Nothing can touch it. Nothing can change this fact. Each moment is totally free and indeterminate from all other moments. So it's perfect. It's flawless. It's flawlessly free. When we say it's perfect, I mean it's perfectly free. It's perfectly indeterminate. It's perfectly flawless. This is what we're asserting. So there are no conditions or situations at all in this instant. It is completely one. It is completely whole. No such thing as a condition, because the next moment can be completely different as far as content of appearance or experiencing. Completely different without the slightest similarity whatsoever. So how can you say there's such a thing as a condition or a situation? There isn't. Or a form or a thing or a place or anything. You cannot say anything at all except this instant is perfect, immaculately perfect. And there's no teaching about this moment, the perfection of this moment. So the ego will say, well, where'd you get that? How do you tie this in with this teaching? Blah, explain, explain. No explanation. It's always been this way. This is not something that's been established through some teaching. Okay? Teachings simply point to what is eternally true and requires no establishment whatsoever. So the teachings don't establish this. The teachings say, Jesus says it himself, he says, let all teachings go, including his teachings. Let all concepts, ideas, all teachings, let them all go. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. All of them. He said, including this teaching that he's giving, let it all go. Because none of that establishes the truth in the slightest bit. The truth is inherently true. It is eternally true. It's unestablished, uncaused, unestablished, unattained, unrealized. It is simply true, always and forever. It is eternal truth. And just simply experience that, is what he says. The ego wants to say, find a chain of causation. Well, how did this get caused? How did it become this way? How did you get there? There's no getting there. It's always been the case. We never left it. You cannot leave it. You cannot make a moment imperfect. You cannot make a moment determinate, meaning this moment was determined by a previous moment. No such causation at all. There is no such causation like that. So the ego keeps insisting, well, how is it, where is the causation? There is no such causation like that, the way that is determinate. There's no determinate causation. There's instantaneous causation. There's spontaneous, concurrent causation. But whatever we desire, the desire and the experience are one. Spontaneously in the moment. Ego say, well, how'd you get this? By evaporating the continuity fear. It's a gradual evaporative, moving the comfort zone gradually. That's how you eventually get this far. So the ego wants you to categorize, wants you to somehow explain. Okay, you get to the mode, no explanation. Very important, no explanation. No explanation required. It's already tacitly understood. One problem, one solution. Continuity problem, evaporate the continuity problem. That's it. It's so self-evident, it's so simple, don't need explanation. You don't need to compound the explanation, you see. This is it. So we just say, well, with explanation, explanations, I've succeeded. Okay, I've succeeded, that's all. It's not an explanation, really. The ego said, that's not an explanation. That's right. So, no explanation. No explanation needed. Who do we need to explain? We need to explain the truth. The ego keeps thinking, they tell us, hey, we need to explain the truth. How do we manage to, you know, there's, we've just been dreaming. We just woke up from the dream. We never left. Moments never cease to be perfect. It's not like we've been going through a whole bunch of imperfect moments and now they're perfect again. See, that's what the ego says. Not true. All moments have always been perfect. Every moment is perfect. You might say there's just this eternal moment that is always free and spontaneous. However you say it, it's always been that way. So, there's no explanation as to how did imperfect moments become perfect, because that's never been the case. And there's no explanation. Well, how did it not be the case? How is it that it managed to not be imperfect? There's no explanation for that either, because it's inherently so. It's the will of God. And they say, well, how come the will of God can't be changed? Because the will of God, it's not the will of God that the will of God be changed. That's why. But the more we engage in that, the more the ego seems to have some power. So it's better to practice full stop in the burn. Keep on practicing what brings up this burn. It agitates the ego, it agitates this. No explanation. Stop. At some point you stop the explanation and go into practice. Now is perfect. This instant is perfect. No explanation. No residue, no explanation. Don't try to figure out what technique you're using. The ego tries to get, well, what's the technique? No, just assert the truth. Just full stop on the truth. This instant is perfect. This instant is immaculately perfect. This instant is pure, unequivocal, no exception, no exemption, immaculately perfect instant. This instant is perfect. This instant is perfect. This instant is perfect. No explanation needed. No residue, no explanation. This incident is perfect. No residue. No residue, no explanation. This incident is perfect. No residue, no explanation. So phase one, two, and three lead up to four, where you're finally so clear about the whole situation, you can even drop the explanation. You don't require concept. You don't require explanation, so you don't require concepts, ideas, all this stuff. You know you're simply stating a fact. That's it. And you know you're just evaporating your continuity fear. You already know that. So it doesn't need to be explained. Now, of course, you will fall back into, you know, a little bit, and you practice, and then you backlash and kind of dip a little bit, and then like yesterday was a very difficult day. Today, I feel much, much, much clearer and better. But now I'm taking on another challenge. So it's like that. Two steps forward, one step back. Don't be disappointed if you don't instantly realize the perfection of this moment. Because the continuity fear, of course, is very severe. It's still with you. Don't try to defeat. Don't label defeat. Don't try to... The continuity fear. The continuity fear is this very amorphous... Fear of perfection is all it is. Don't try to turn it into some other fear. It's just a fear of perfection. You keep saying, I'm not ready for it. I'm not used to it. I'm not used to perfection. That's all it is. So you don't need to slice and dice it. And, no, it's just a fear of perfection. So you just say, okay, accept it. Okay, I'm afraid of perfection. That's fine. But I'm not quite as afraid as I was before. So keep evaporating this fear of perfection. As long as we're afraid of perfection, we'll need the ego as a protector from perfection, you see? So, just understand, okay, the ego still has some attraction to me because it seems to be my defender from perfection, but I need it less and less and less. Even to the point where I don't need to dialogue with it anymore. No explanation. No dialogue, no explanation. This instant is perfect. No dialogue, no explanation. This instant is perfect. No dialogue, no explanation. So you start out asserting. And gradually we're moving towards actually experiencing this. But at first we will assert it. And it may seem that we can go deeper, but you have to start, you have to crawl before you can walk. So this instant is perfect. No exceptions, no exemptions, no residue, no explanation, no dialogue. Full stop in the burn. This moment does not require explanation. This moment does not require any explanation to any other moment. Perfect. It doesn't need to explain this moment how it managed to not be the same as that other moment, because the basis of reality is total freedom. It's just as pure spaciousness saturating all everywhere. Doesn't have any preferences of what arises in what kind of color birds fly through the sky. It doesn't change the fact that the pure spaciousness saturates everywhere. Any bird of any type can fly through the sky at any moment. It doesn't matter. Each moment, pure spaciousness is absolutely purely saturating everywhere and supports the appearance of any bird flying through the sky. This moment can be a flock of a billion birds. The next moment can be one green bird flying through the sky. It's all the same to pure spaciousness. Pure spaciousness is always equally saturating everywhere. So it doesn't change the perfection that is pure spaciousness doesn't change that in the slightest bit. The presence or absence of any appearance doesn't change. If you have a flock of a billion birds this moment, the next moment there's one green bird. The absence of that flock of billion birds doesn't change. It's the saturation of pure spaciousness everywhere. It doesn't change in the slightest bit. Color, quantity, quality, none of that has any effect on pure spaciousness. So each moment, the absolute presence is exactly the same. You see, pure supportive presence is always the case. And does not require any moment to be linked to some other moment. Say, wait a minute, how did we get from that flock of a billion birds to one bird? You know, what was the process? There's no process. Simply what we desire. We desire to see just one green bird flying through the air. Okay, that's what we see now. Now we want a billion, oh gosh, a billion birds flying, a billion yellow birds flying through the sky. Oh, in some flock, y'all. Okay, that's what we're seeing now. There doesn't need to be any causal link at all. We are the cause. Spirit, the desire to experience, that is the one and only cause. And God is the pure, supportive presence that enables all this to be experienced with no preferences, pure love, pure supportiveness, pure absence of all quality, which enables then any and all qualities to arise or not arise, manifest or not manifest, makes no difference. Doesn't make any difference if that flock of a billion yellow birds is not manifest right now. It's pure potential. God is pure potential. Pure potential. Pure unequivocal potential, without exception, without exemption. Always the purity of all potential is always there, simultaneously always there. Nothing is added, nothing is subtracted. If something manifests, that potential for it to manifest again is always present. See, the pure potential is never exhausted by any manifestation at all. Manifest a billion yellow birds, and that potential to do so is always present, and you can do it over and over and over again infinitely if you want, and it doesn't exhaust the potential in the slightest bit. Or don't manifest over and over and over and over, don't manifest the birds over and over, and that doesn't exhaust the potential, doesn't kill the potential at all. God is life, so the potential can't be killed at all. The fact that you may not manifest some appearance doesn't kill off the potential to manifest. All pure potential is omnipresent, always present, eternally present, everlasting pure potentiality. So we're perfectly free. It's not like we have to manifest something to keep it from dying. Not like that at all. We're under no obligation our preferences whatsoever, that we need to manifest this or not manifest that. None. That means we're perfectly free. So hearing this brings up a burn. I'm feeling it right now. It's like, wow. The burn means we're moving our comfort zone closer to truth, to accepting truth. That produces a burn, an agitation. And we move our comfort zone by just speaking easily and freely about this. You see? And then it's like, oh wow. We're not analyzing it. It's this breezy, self-evident type of style of talking about it. Like, of course this is true. This is obviously, of course this is right, right? Just to hear that, just full stop in that. Don't analyze. Don't think there's some notion need to discuss or analyze or anything. It's self-evident, self-evidency. No struggle with the struggle. No explanation about self-evidency. So this talk is not really explanation so much as it's just self-evidency, expressing self-evidency. This is the field to it, just expressing self-evidency. Of course, this is true. And then this brings up the burn of moving the comfort zone. So your practice should be keep working, keep practicing, and keep working until you feel that you've moved your comfort zone. And then you'll feel this different feeling like, wow, I just shifted my comfort zone. This is, then you're in this burn. Yeah, just full stop in that. Don't, just full stop in it. I just went around the bend in the road. Oh, wow, it's a different vista here. Wow. So there's a difference between someone who's just dogmatically asserting some teaching they've memorized and they're dogmatic, and someone who sees it and is expressing the spontaneity and the freshness of it and the self-evidency of it. There's a big difference, right? You can feel the difference. So I'm seeing it for myself here. I'm seeing, wow. So I'm just expressing what I'm seeing. Whereas the dogmatic teachers will take some text that's written down and they'll memorize the text and then they'll just repeat, you know, what's there. Now, this can help in phase one and phase two. But as you get into phase three and phase four, it's more and more and more what you're seeing. And listening to the freshness of explanation. Something's fresh, not dogmatic. So this is all spontaneous for me. It's not dogmatic. So in the videos, I've tried to always make it spontaneous and fresh. I don't go on notes. I don't, for the most part, I did read Longchenpa's book, but I try to do it in a fresh, breezy way, like a self-evident way. And so this is the flavor. This is what moves the comfort zone. Is you're feeling the self-evidency of this. So when you practice, put it into your own words. Put it in your own words. Now, of course, I'm getting words from Jesus and Longchenpa primarily as to far as how to express this. But it's still my own words, and I'm getting it from seeing it. So what you do is you see it and then express it. Keep working on your own expression of it, You might use some of the words I've used. You might put in a different terminology. But practice using your own, practice being spontaneous in your expressions of it, coming from you, what you're seeing, from what you are seeing, not dogmatic. But certainly you can get inspiration from something that's fresh, and you realize, yeah, this is possible. But nobody needs to be a parrot just repeating dogmatically what someone else said. For the sake of practicing, it's also helpful to have someone say, okay, we're going to just say, do it this instant. Do it now. You know, this instant is perfect. For the sake of practicing, we accept this. These are very simple, effective expressions. But you can also come up with your own practices. Absolutely. Both are helpful. But by all means, do come up with the Holy Spirit letting you come up with some of your own practice. Do that, and also your own expressions. Keep practicing that too, for sure. So you don't fall in the dogmaticism. That's the pyramid scheme, being dogmatic. Because you think, I can't look at that. But someone else looked at it, I'll just take their word and be dogmatic about it. And I can get an exception by studying and being a dutiful studier of this teaching and memorize it, and then this will earn me an exemption. Not true at all. As Jesus says, drop all conceptuality, ideas, notions, learning, everything. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. Even his teaching, let it all go. And experience the perfection of this moment. So certainly, we have to get, you know, more and more free of dogmatic teaching, the dogmatism, absolutely. And at the same time, honoring the example that those who have been free have given, the words they've given us, the encouragement, honoring those too. It's not like we don't hate it or anything, but we use it as a springboard, like a diving board in a pool, to jump off of the diving board and into the pool. And more importantly than that, just work, do whatever you need to do to get into this burn of moving your comfort zone. Whatever you, however you could do it, use it to get into this burn. Of moving your comfort zone. Nothing has to arise, nothing has to subside. Arising and subsiding do not change the pure potentiality in the slightest bit ever. See, we have this underlying belief that if we don't manifest something, that means its potential will be vitiated and it will go into decay. Not true at all. Even if we don't manifest some experience forever, so to speak, the pure potentiality of it is completely untouched and immaculate. And anything we do manifest produces no residue whatsoever. None, no residue. The potentiality of it is still absolutely immaculate and pure. Didn't use up anything, did not produce any residue whatsoever. Residue free. All experiencing and non-experiencing is residue free. And again, I mention great, great thanks to Longjempa for helping us out at this time. Somehow his grace got Keith Dauman to give this great translation of his works that somehow resonates with us very clearly. And this enables us to really, you know, get tremendous transmission help in this fourth phase from someone who's an expert at this. So, great thanks for this help. It was very helpful, very helpful. He sort of gives us a way of talking about this, a way of looking at it that just strikes really freeing, you know, no residue. I mean, who would come up with that? No residue. But it just feels so true. Whether you manifest or don't manifest, neither one produces the slightest residue of all pure potentiality. And just resting in that is just terrific. This really produces an agitation within. It's just, oh my gosh. Because this truly dissolves some of the very root of our fear and belief system. That somehow we have to manifest something in particular to prevent it from decaying or having trouble. Not true. Not true at all. Truly undoes dualism. Dualistic teaching has a lot to do with saying that God created us human beings to come to this world and do something specific mission and to get rid of the darkness and all blah, 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 blah. None of that's true. Absolutely not true in the slightest bit. Whether anything manifests or does not manifest, does not produce the slightest residue whatsoever. Pure potentiality remains absolutely immaculately untouched. This blows the cobwebs out of the mind, doesn't it? It really does. So let this breeze just keep blowing through our minds, and gradually it will get rid of the cobwebs. Absolutely. No residue. That's why no residue is such an important practice. No residue. Full stop. No residue. No explanation. No additional explanation required. No residue. What's really saying, we're free. We're absolutely free. God has not put us on some mission that we must accomplish for God. We understand pragmatically, we have a continuity fear, therefore you can say there's a pragmatic, helpfulness here. But no, God's still, we're completely free. There's no such thing as any mission. How could there be? Every moment is perfect. What kind of mission could there be? There's no residue anywhere. Dualism says that somehow there's some residue been produced because we manifested something or didn't manifest something, and therefore we got to go fix that and clean that up. It is absolutely not true. There's no residue anywhere. No moment produces any residue whatsoever. None. This staggers the mind, because the mind has been believing, this belief system, that its purpose is to clean up this residue somehow. And suddenly, the mind feels, well, no, I don't have any such purpose. It staggers the mind. So then just full stop in this staggered mindness. So what I'm experiencing right now is a staggered mind, very much so. A lot of shaking and trembling going on throughout the whole structure of the belief system. The mind has been believing it and putting its attention on. The mind believing that it has some purpose it has to fulfill, some specific purpose it must fulfill to clean up some residue, fix something, not true. Nothing that needs to be fixed. There's never been any residue. Ever. Again, all praise to the teacher Jesus Christ and Longchenpa for this. For this help in seeing this. Jesus saying, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them all go, including all my teaching, including all my teaching. Let it all go, you see. It's the best teaching of all, isn't it? Let go of all teaching, including my teaching, you see. He didn't say, let go of all other teaching and hold on to mine. He said, let go of all teaching, including mine. This is a true teacher. God doesn't give the mind specific purposes. God gives the mind, spirit, freedom. Complete lack of specificity, complete lack of determinism, total freedom, indeterminate, totally indeterminate. So again, I'm experiencing the staggered mind, which is what the purpose of spiritual practice is, to stagger the mind with truth. And the mind like wakes, it's like waking up, like, wow, wait a minute. I've been sleeping, you know. the mind saying, whoa, 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 I've been sleeping. Wow, I've been believing something false. It staggers the mind. So this is why we sit quietly without moving so much, without getting up out of our seat, without scratching or itching or coughing or doing anything. You just let the mind be staggered. We can take a sip of water. It's fine. When you commit to this, sitting quietly, you then allow the mind to be staggered, and you don't feel in danger by this. Now, sometimes I've found that when you're driving on a familiar route, you go into autopilot mode, and you can also have the mind staggered while you're driving. I've actually experienced